Like to welcome you to our wonderful family service. My name is Pastor Gregory Guice, and this is
Thomas B.K. Calhoun.
And today is a very special day because this is my co-host all the way from Howard University. I'm so glad to have you a part of this service.
It's a blessing to be here, and it's a blessing to be able to speak to you now.
Amen. For those of you who don't know, on our family Sunday service, we always bring up a co-host, and I'm so grateful that you're here with me. So we truly want you to know
We're welcoming you to Detroit Unity Temple, where the opportunities and challenges of living meet the awesome power of God.
And if you're joining from around the world via the internet, we welcome you into our spiritual community. We have a fabulous service for you today, and we just want to say thank you for being a part of this wonderful moment. And my good friend and myself, of course, we are having our separate distancing as we have to do today. But I'd like to begin this service off with the reading of today's daily word. I'm going to ask Thomas to do that daily word for us. So go to it, my friend.
Today's word is joy. The affirmation is, joy is my constant companion. I discover reasons to feel joyful every day, even in the most challenging circumstances. I begin by centering my awareness on the Christ, the divine presence within. I feel love and peace lift my heart, and possibilities for good fill my thoughts. I am joyous. I may experience joy as exuberance, delight, and wonder. Joy may also come quietly as the peaceful assurance of God's presence wherever I am, whatever I'm doing. My awareness of joy brings a glow to even the most ordinary day. As I engage wholeheartedly in all that is mine to do today, I share my joy with everyone. Through kind words, a sunny smile, and a warm welcome to the very one I meet, I radiate joy and bless the world with my positivity, happiness, and bliss. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Psalm 118:24.
My good friend, what a joy to the reading of those words. So now let us all affirm our congregational mission statement together. Our mission and goal is to prayerfully demonstrate the teachings of Jesus Christ through the study and practice of truth principles.
Now, let us affirm our vision statement for the Living Temple. We, the spiritual community of Detroit Unity, joyously carry out the vision of renewal and prosperity for ourselves, our spiritual home, and our world.
We have something that is called food for thought. And I want to share this with you right now. You have all the reason in the world to achieve your grandestness. Your grandest dreams, imaginations, plus innovation equal realization. I'm going to say that again. You have all the reason in the world to achieve your grandest dream, which is your imagination plus innovation equal realization. Isn't that a powerful thought, sir?
It's amazing, and it's exactly what we need in these trying times to realize our imagination.
Amen. Yeah. So if this is your first time joining Detroit Unity Temple, we welcome you and we ask that you tell others to join us via the internet at www.detroitunity.com and click the red button for our Sunday worship service. The button is to be taking us to our broadcast every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Would you agree?
Please.
And when the global health concern is clear, we encourage everyone to visit the temple to be a part of our live service and in person. That's a personal invitation from us. Would you agree with that? Join us for that?
It's such a necessity with churches being closed all over the country that we continue to pray and send our blessings to the world.
So we want you to join us right now for our special hymn for the day. And I would like for you to just right now join us as we invite Charles and Gwen Scales to take us right to that wonderful song that they have planned for you right now. So Gwen and Charles Scales, a beautiful song. I know you're going to enjoy that. Let's welcome them in, okay? All right. My good friend, this is the time we take time to acknowledge the people and things in our lives that we are grateful for. So we know that right now there's a lot of individuals. So who would you like to acknowledge in your life right now? Maybe we'd like to send a positive blessing out to.
Well, of course, my parents, who have been so supportive in all of my recent endeavors, my sister and her best friend, Kyra. But additionally, I have so many wonderful friends who have really been caring for me, protecting me, and praying for me. And as I've been able to share that same sentiment towards them during the revolution that our world is witnessing.
You know, as I say every week, we want you to take a moment and just hold someone in your thoughts who you love, who you want to pray for. And I would like to do the same for my family, for my wife, to those who I love. Take a moment to think of someone in your life right now who you care for, because this is that moment we give to them when we just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. So call someone and tell them to join us for this wonderful service, because I guarantee you this first Sunday in June is very special. This is our family service. So call a member of your family and tell them you got to watch this, because we have something specially planned for this service. So right now, I'd like to bring to the podium our very own Miss Bessie Harris.
Thank you, Reverend and Thomas. I am just so grateful for all of you out there and my Detroit Unity family. At this time, please let us affirm our statement of truth together, please. There is only one presence and one power active in my life and in the universe, God the good, omnipotent. Now let us say the prosperity thought for the week, and I will say it one time and then you can join in the second time. I envision good unfolding in every area of my life. Let me give you a minute for that to just resonate. We can say it again together now. I envision good unfolding in every area of my life. Oh, that's powerful. Now, as usual, at this time, I ask that you please tune out all worldly distractions, everything that might be distracting you in your home. Become comfortable wherever you are as we prepare for meditation by singing the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and leave us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
So I now ask that you find a comfortable space wherever you are. A space where you're able to relax and breathe in and out the love of God at your own pace. In and out the love of God. And we say, Father, Mother, everything God. We enter into your presence with an open heart and mind. We come asking that you would be that balm in Gilead, the one we know will make the wounded whole. As we look around at the condition of our world today, we may become fretful, frustrated, or even fearful. Then we remember that you have given us a spirit of love, of power, and of a sound mind, that you told us to hold our peace and allow you to fight our battles, and that we will have what we say. Let us take a moment right now to think of the battles that until now we thought we had to fight by ourselves. And then we thank you, God, for the power of imagination, that even in the midst of a raging storm, we can align our mind with God's mind and create the outcomes that we want in our lives and in our world. We affirm that believing is seeing, and we see for us what you see in us. Nothing but good. It is so, and so it is. Amen.
Written by Mr. John Lennon. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky. Imagine all of the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. And no religion to. judging all of the people, living life in peace. You, oh, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join me, and the world will be as one. Imagine no possessions. I wonder if you care. Oh, no need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man. Imagine all sharing all the world. You, oh, you may say that I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope one day you will join us, and the world will be as one. It will be as one. I wanna know, can you imagine when we have nothing to kill or die for? Living in peace, the world will be as one. Be as one. The world will be as one.
Imagine, wow, that is a classical and a wonderful song. Imagine. I know it took you to the same place that it took me. Melanie gave a wonderful meditation, and this is the moment that there's so much that the world should be involved in right now. When I start asking God what we should do, I just sit down and allow spirit to take over. You know, God is such a special, wonderful presence in our lives. And as things were taking place throughout this world, God touched me, and I just knew it was something important. But before I go there, I just needed to get centered. So before I go into my talk, I just want you to allow me to get centered and start this moment off the correct way. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your path, and guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation, and I will wait on thee all the day long. You know, this is the time period when we just take a moment and talk about the power of the month. The power of the month is imagination. The spiritual power that is represented by the disciple Bartholomew. And the coordinating color is light blue, and the physical location is between the eyes. And I want to say the affirmation. It's called, I envision good unfolding in every area of my life. And I want to say that again. I envision good unfolding in every area of my life. Oh, God is so good. I want to take you with me on a journey, because this week, all of us could not help but see the news of what was taking place in our country. And I received a phone call from a young man who's here with me right now. And that young man said, Reverend Guice, I need to talk to you. And this is a young man who has been not only just a wonderful student, but I see him as a friend, as a presence of God that I just simply know that God has his hand on his life. So Mr. Thomas Calhoun V, I want you to join me up here. We're going to take a seat. So bear with us as we share an open conversation about what's going on in the world right now. Because he asked me a question and shared with me some thoughts and some things that were taking place in his life. So we're going to shift the energy right now and just have a real spiritual conversation. So we're going to get started right now. Well, my good friend, it is so good to have you here with me. Of all of you who are watching, I just want to take you back into a conversation. Thank you for joining me here on this moment. For those of you who don't know Thomas, I'm going to have Thomas share something about himself. But before he does that, I want to take you into the conversation with this question he asked me. He told me something that he was involved in. And Thomas was concerned about what was taking place because of Mr. George Floyd. And throughout the world, there was protesting and peace movements and peace marches taking place. But if I'm correct, you are currently a student at Howard University.
That is correct.
A graduate out of our very own YOU. But you were motivated on the 28th and 29th of May to do something by yourself. You decided to have your own peace march on the corner of Evergreen and 12 Mile Road.
Martin Luther King, so around 10 miles actually.
10 miles.
Yeah.
And you decided by yourself to go out there and have a singular one-man peace demonstration.
Correct.
What motivated you by yourself to stand on a corner? Did you have a sign?
Yeah.
And what did you tell us about that?
I woke up the morning of the 28th, and it was a dear friend of mine's birthday, but I couldn't feel happy about it because I woke up to videos of Target burning to the ground, of nearly 100 police officers standing outside of Derek Chauvin's house rather than arresting him. I woke up to rioting in Minnesota that was being captured and broadcast on Twitter and various other social media platforms for the world to see. And it made my heart hurt to the point where I felt like I had to be involved. I felt as though for me to not do something would be the same as acting as if what they're doing is unjust.
Well, that was the reason that the title of my talk was Imagine That You Can Make a Difference. So often, many times, people don't believe that they can make a difference, but in that moment, that one moment, you felt that you could make a difference on that corner by yourself. Not just one day. You came back another day on the 29th. What happened on that first day and the second day? Did people notice you? How long did you stay on the corner?
On the 28th, I stood out from 11:30 in the morning to 4:30 by myself. And I was actually noticed by a man who represents the Democratic Party of Southfield. He's the chair. And he came out and gave me his business card and said that I should get in contact with him. And in that moment, I realized that there was some value to what I was doing. I went out there not expecting to make a change, but just feeling as if I was overwhelmed by a God presence that made me so passionate for the cause.
As you said, it was a God presence moving inside of you.
Exactly.
As if something that morning woke you up, that told you that you can make a difference, and you was moved to go out there. Did you ever hear the story of Dr. King, how he was motivated, how he decided that he was going to get out and go and just stand out there? He just decided to pray, and he decided to create. That's what the movement is all about, when God stirs something inside of you to go and do something. What took place on the 29th?
On the 29th, I went out again at 11:30 in the morning, and after a few hours, I was joined by my friend Cynthia, who is a member of Renaissance Unity. And with the two of us holding signs, we were also joined by two people who I had never even met. The energy in that moment was so enlightening, because I realized that with every car that passed and saw what our signs read, they would honk their horn. I had a sign that said the name George Floyd, the hashtag police reform, and the hashtag BLM, Black Lives Matter. And
say that again, please.
George Floyd in big capital letters, and just below it, hashtag police reform, and the hashtag BLM, Black Lives Matter.
Police reform, Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
You know, so often too many people feel that they may not have a name or their energy may not matter. But in that one or those 2 days of demonstration, the 28th and 29th, that inspired you to do even more. What took place the rest of the day for you?
That Friday, Cynthia and I together went downtown where arguably 1,000 people from Detroit and from the neighboring cities came out to have a peaceful protest. It was scheduled from 4:00 to 5:30, and it was a march. And when we arrived, it was one of the most amazing things I'd ever witnessed in my life, because of the fact that there was such a diverse group and so many people were so spirited for the sake of finding peace in this turmoil that has been created. But we also witnessed a lot of turbulence because of people's anger and their outrage. We watched what was a peaceful protest get turned violent, right before our eyes. And it was scary. It was scary to see people's rage come alive. It was scary to see it's happened so close to us, but it was also scary to realize how real this is. This time that we're living is one like no other, in all honesty. And in that moment, in the city of Detroit, Cynthia, one of my best friends and I, we were able to firsthand see what real frustration looks like.
Have you, up to that point, had any idea of the frustration or what it was like from the past? Because this is not something new. This is a continuation. We've talked about this. We've talked about this as the whole idea that 50 years ago, myself, I was in your shoes. 50 years ago, we can go back 60 years, that this is a continuation of civil unrest that have taken place in America. And for African Americans, this has been something that's been ongoing.
Ongoing, and it's existed not only throughout the duration of our lives, but throughout the duration of this country's existence. This country was built upon slavery, and the slaves were freed, and to some people that was like, okay, you guys got what you wanted, but that wasn't fair. So we lived through years of turmoil and fighting until we were finally granted the right to vote. And in that moment, it seemed as if victory was nearly won. But what we are seeing today, what we are seeing in this current climate of the world, is a reminder that the eyes on the prize,
right,
is never true. It hasn't been reached, and we still have to keep going.
And we can never discount the victories or the achievements that have been had.
Absolutely not. We cannot discount anything that's been done, but we have to keep going.
I was talking to an elder who was in her 90s.
Right.
And she said she would have never thought she would have seen a black president. But she told me she cried when President Obama became a president. She cried because she thought it was something she never would have achieved. So she felt that her struggle and those years of marching had some dividend for her. So sometimes when it seems as if it has no merit or has no benefit, she felt the years that she marched, the years that she overcame the injustice, was able to elevate him to a higher level. It brought him into that office. So she felt that her tears mounted and gave her something to cheer. So even though when it seems like the darkness is there, through our effort, through that peace movement, it brought something of a greater value that she was able to cling on to. So there's something that even though when it seems like the darkness is there, there's light that's going to lift up and bring us something greater.
Absolutely. And the light that is shining over our world right now is one that is so hopeful and so promising, but we have to feed it. I was 8 years old when the first black president was elected. And that happened into, like, his presidency was throughout my entire upbringing. I was 16 when his term ended, meaning that I did not experience that fear of never being able to see it. I know what it looks like. And it was immediately followed by Donald Trump, who is the complete foil. He is the antithesis of what that freedom represents. But at the end of Donald Trump's term, we have a hope that I never thought I'd see manifest worldwide. We have protests going on our behalf in France, in New Zealand, in every state in this country, 50 states, every major city holding protests, holding peaceful, prayerful demonstrations, hopeful demonstrations, diverse demonstrations to show that we are not defined by our history. We are not defined by negativity. We are defined
by people are coming together in a spirit of oneness.
Oneness in the light.
Talking about Black Lives Matter.
Right.
That talking about the fact that, as Obama said, yes, we can. There's a different spirit here. There's not a spirit of hopelessness, but a spirit that it can be achieved. Look what we did with Congress when the very progressive women took Congress by storm and was able to stand up. Sometimes the darkness don't want you to see your achievement. Sometimes the darkness want to paint a cloud as if to make you think that something can't be achievable. But yet, when you look at all the good that has happened, It want to deter you from what's possible. You know, as the message says, imagine you can make a difference. Think about the possibilities when people do join together and show all the greatness that's there in your grasp of what you want to make it seem like. You talked about all the peaceful demonstrations and all the love. When you were in those peaceful demonstrations, how much love was there with you?
Well, fortunately enough, I've been able to experience it in, you know, not only other neighboring cities, but in my own. Following the demonstration on the 29th, I scheduled one in advance and invited people out to come to Southfield on the 31st. And
Wait, you scheduled and you organized own peaceful demonstration.
I did. I had flyers made. I talked to the police department, and I watched as what was just me became a crowd of 60 with the support of the chief of police, the support of the chair of the Democratic Party, the support of the chief of staff of the Senate, and everyone there agreeing that there is a capacity for change. I went to a protest in Troy where we started at Somerset and marched through the street to the police station, and it was the most liberating thing I've ever encountered in my life, because it shows we want peace. We are capable. We have the energy. We have the wisdom of the elders and the young people's energy, and we have the heart and the dedication.
Imagine that you can make a difference, right? But you said something, the wisdom of the elders and the energy of the youth.
Correct. It's a quote from Common in the song Glory.
Say that again.
It's a quote from Common in the song Glory.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because that's the other illusion that some people want us not to have together, is to be able to work with the wisdom of the elders and the energy of the youth. Because if we're connected together, we're working together to see that our ability to build that bridge and see how valuable we are together. You know, that's why when we see that effort working together and see that we can have that harmony together, because see, I think I was telling you 50 years ago, I had to listen to my elders, and here you are doing something, but what you did in your own spirit is organizing and working with the police. But what about, you were going to ask me a question, I think, about those individuals who wanted to move from peace to destruction.
So, fortunately, I'm from a location in this country where we have police officers that want to support us. They want us to use our voices. The city of Southfield, you know, West Bloomfield, even Detroit, we have police officers that want to see change. They don't stand by what happened. But all over the country, we have cases of violence being instigated during nonviolent demonstrations by people who genuinely are just angry, but by people who come with the intent of watching it become a riot. And I witnessed it. I witnessed it with my own eyes.
What do you mean you witnessed it? You saw people coming outside of our city, coming into our city with the intention of instigating and starting a violent moment.
I can't speak to their backgrounds.
Okay.
But I can say that I watched police escorts who were leading our march have their vehicles destroyed by protesters who got in front of their cars and bashed the windshields. And it's painful. It's painful because I wasn't there to see a riot, and yet at 1:30 in the morning, that same night, there was tear gas being thrown. There were people being arrested. There was so much pain in the city of Detroit. And of course, this is the first night of several nights of violent protests that this city has seen. And what I witnessed personally, it was terrifying, not just because of the fact that it was violent, not just because of the obvious trauma that it would, you know, leave with anybody, but because of the fact that it means that there are people who don't understand, or people that want to silence the actual cause.
You know, Dr. King was a wonderful example of what he had to go through. In his most difficult time, which takes me, we're talking about wisdom, right? When he had to go into Cicero, Chicago, he had to go into a moment where he was being called all sorts of names, and they were throwing bricks at him and throwing all kinds of objects at him, but he stuck to his cause. He maintained his strength, and he went into that situation, and he even got hit upside the head with a brick one time and was being bloodied. In those moments, he maintained his foundation of love. Even when those dark moments occur, that's how you gain that strength, because your purpose is so strong. Maintain that element of peace. That's what strengthens the movement for peace, because the opposition is always going to try to weaken you in those moments. There's been no struggle gained without that resistance, but that's where you gain that victory. That's how you gain that ability to overcome. That's how you move forward. That's how people rally around you. That's why we see George Floyd movement so strong, because people realize. And when his family stood up there and said, we still want peace, we still want a peaceful movement. If you look back at every movement, those individuals who was in that bus counter and they stood at those Woolworth counters and they had people dumping food on them, slapping them upside their head, but they had a purpose in that Woolworth counter, because they knew that they wanted to bring the ability for people to be able to sit in segregated counters, and they sacrificed themselves. That's what this is all about. When those people rode those buses in the South and had them threatened to be blown up, they sacrificed that moment for peace and the opportunity for us to ride those buses. They never yield, they never forgot, they never were able to be afraid. So that's what these peaceful movements bring about. Yes, there were individuals who came along and wanted to say, stop it. Or, man, fear, can you imagine what fear was to ride a bus in the South during that time period? And they wanted to quit or stop. But no, they rode those buses through the South, knowing that they're going to have threats, knowing that they may be blowed up or sit at that counter, knowing that the challenges that was going to come behind that. And these peaceful movements are necessary. Mm-hmm. And the ones that want to cause that, don't even worry about them. Continue to have these peaceful demonstrations. And everyone that takes the knee, everyone that kneels, is demonstrating love. Because the bottom line is love is still the strongest vibration there is in the world.
And when you spoke to me on the phone, I'll never forget, you said, no matter what you're doing, remember to love. And I was sitting in my car, and I pulled out my phone so I could type it down, because this is a moment where people think they feel hate. People think that's what they feel, but that's not what this is. It's anger, and it's justified anger. But hate is an illusion. We right now, we are faced with oppressive systems that have held back African Americans for so long. Systematic oppression is a well-known issue. And once upon a time, its strength was in fear. But that isn't the case now, because we know what love is, to the point where we can strip the power from those systems simply by choosing to love, choosing to approach things from a place of peace and logic.
Of Absolutely. Course,
it's anger is a natural response. There are going to be people who don't know how to express their frustration through any way other than the urge to destroy. And that's fair, because we are black people.
Yeah. Think about it. Nelson Mandela could have stayed in anger. Nelson Mandela could have came out of prison with nothing but anger. Instead, he brought love with him. Mm-hmm. For a whole nation, regardless of who they were, Indian, South Africans, he held love that raised him to the level of being the president of South Africa. Love is that strongest power that was healed this nation. Love is going to be what carries us to vote in November. Love is going to be what changed this nation around. Love has been the most freeing power. Love is what made Harriet Tubman go back
and forth through the South to free the slave. Love is the strength that lifted you up, that made you stand on that corner on the 28th, the 29th, that brought people to see you. You stood there because you loved what was inside of you, that God moved you. Love is the reason you make a difference in this world, that brings you together. I mean, it was what fueled Dr. King. Dr. King had the greatest message in the world. Jesus Christ says, love one another as I have loved you. Why did he go on a cross and sacrifice himself? Because it was love. God is love, the greatest energy in the world. And I'm going to tell you what we're going to do. You and myself is going to make a demonstration of love right now. We're going to take a knee, just like everybody else is doing. So for George Floyd, for everyone else.
Breonna Taylor, Philando Castile.
Trayvon Martin.
So many.
So we're going to light a candle for everyone here. So for those of you who are at home, if you want to take a knee in your house with your family as a loving demonstration, I want you to just kneel in the chair where you may be at, and Thomas is going to take a knee for those who can kneel on their floor. And for those of you who can't kneel on the floor, I want you to just kneel in your chair where you may be at. But the point is to make a demonstration that will demonstrate our love for those who went before us. So right now, this demonstration is for George Floyd, for the various cities of people who are peacefully demonstrating all across the world, demonstrating for love, for peace, whether it's in Chicago, whether it's in Detroit or California.
In Philadelphia, Virginia, where I go to school, in DC, everywhere.
We want you to know right now that we know that you're sending out a message, that we can make a peaceful demonstration. Imagine that you can make a difference right here. And if you're watching this video, this moment, this broadcast, know that right now you are an instrument of God. And so we are kneeling so that everyone would know that we are supporting this message that came from so many for our children. That right here, right now, we can stand, as that song said, that we can be a demonstration of life. So we want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for each and every one of you who are making a demonstration. So don't let it end right now. Let that demonstration continue on in your life. And so it is, and so it is. Amen.
Now let us prepare to bless and be blessed through our tithes and offerings. So let us hold our offering in our hands. And I truly know that if you appreciated that moment, so let's affirm this right now.
Let us say together, divine love in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive.
We want to say thank you and everyone who has continued to bless Detroit Unity Temple with your tithes and donations. Your generosity is greatly appreciated. So please click the donation button on the www.detroitunity.com and use the temple drop button at the Second Avenue entrance. You can check with your bank to set up direct pay or mail your love offering to Detroit Unity Temple, 17505 Second Avenue, Detroit, Michigan, 48203 is so amazing. So let us once again bless this with a song from Gwen and Charles Scales, which we truly love. They are amazing. So thank you kindly as we hear this magnificent song.
This is a song that was written a while ago. Different period, but same message. We need you to stand today.
to do. Stand, there's a cross for you to bear. Things to go through if you're going anywhere. For the things you know are right, it's the truth that the truth makes them so uptight. Stand, all the things you want are real. You have you to complete, and there is no dear. There's somebody standing tall, and a giant beside him about to fall. Stand, they will try to make you crawl, and they know what you're saying makes sense at all. Stand. Your mind if you want to be.
COVID-19 quarantine, please reach out to your friends and family and invite them to join our Sunday service broadcast. This is when everyone must be strong in faith and look to the divine light of God to bring us through these trying times. Log in to www.detroitunity.com and click on the red Sunday worship service button to view our broadcast at 10 a.m. every Sunday morning.
And we just want you to know that this is so important that you join us here. But right now, I'd like to bring forth our very own Miss Betsy Harris with today's announcements.
All I can say is wow, 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 wow. Thank you, Reverend and Thomas. Oh my God, I know out there you felt the love. It was just going through. And Thomas, I just want to say, I know I'm going to live to see you be mayor. So I've already claimed that for you. Good morning, Detroit Unity Temple. Detroit Unity Temple prayer chaplains and board of trustee members will continue making wellness calls throughout the month of June. Each and every one of you, you're important to us, and we hope to find you and your loved ones safe and healthy. If you are grieving the loss of a loved one and need someone to talk to, please contact Open Arms Grief and Loss Program, and they can be contacted at area code 313-369-5780. Heart-Centered Metaphysics class is Thursday evenings from 6 to 8 p.m. via Zoom. You can email dutreception@gmail.com to register. Please, when you email, put heart-centered in the subject line. This will be an ongoing class. Caregiver support groups will meet by teleconference on the second and fourth Thursdays of the month. The next session is June 11th from 1 to 3. To register for this group, please call Marilyn Lawson at area code 313-289-9672. Inner City Youth Group will distribute meals provided by Forgotten Harvest every Thursday now through June 18th from 10:30 to 12:30 p.m. The location, the pickup location, is in the Detroit Unity Temple overflow parking lot, which is directly across the street at 17425 2nd Avenue. Please call the Dollar Thought line at 313, area code 345-5070 for a powerful word of encouragement. Again, because encouragement is needed, please call our Dollar Thought line at area code 313-345-5070. Detroit Unity Temple is trying to stay connected with you, our church family. If you have not been receiving our weekly email and you would like to, please send your email address to dutreception@gmail.com. Check your spam and junk folders to make sure it's not in there. And please add us as your contact. July birthday and anniversary people, all our July birthdays and anniversaries, if you would like your special day recognized during our service, please send your name and date of birth or marriage to dutreception@gmail.com. Now, for July birthdays, it must be in by June 30th. And please, in the subject line, put the word party. Reverend, this concludes my announcements for this Sunday.
Thank you for being a part and joining me here.
I'm so grateful to be able to come out here and use my voice. It's what's needed right now.
How's Howard University?
It's an experience. It's an amazing experience. One of the best things I could have ever asked to experience.
Now, you in the marching band as well.
Yes, sir.
You enjoying that?
Oh, Showtime has blessed me with being able to travel the country, you know,
well,
Chicago.
What is Showtime?
That's the name of our marching band. The Showtime marching band has been representing Howard University for around 50 years almost.
Now, where is your chair with the Showtime?
Oh, well, my freshman year, they decided they were going to get rid of section leaders after they named that I was going to be one of them. So I guess I'm doing well, even though, you know, our band director retired after my freshman year, so.
Charles, we got to bring him back so he can bring his horn one time, right?
Maybe. I might have to.
Well, right now, this is that time of the month, the first part of the month. So this is time for the birthdays.
Oh, yeah.
And anniversary for all those who have a birthday in the month of June. If you have sent your birthday in for the month of June, I'm not going to call them out. Right now, you should see the names of those individuals who have a birthday in the month of June strolling down right about now, and you would see those names coming down. So we right now would like to sing happy birthday to all the names that was sent in to us. So if you didn't get it in, you got a chance for next week. But right now, these are the ones we're gonna sing happy birthday to. So Gwen and Charles, are you ready? Let's sing happy birthday to them. Happy birthday to all of you Geminis and Cancers who was in the month of June. Now we have this time, we're going to have a special for those who are having an anniversary. And you may have seen their names coming down, particularly Charles and Connie Porter. That's the only names I'm going to call off because they're having 67 years of love. So right now let's sing happy anniversary to those who may have sent in their anniversary name that's being strolled down as well. So let's sing happy anniversary to them as well. Take it away, Gwen and Charles Scales.
Happy anniversary.
All right. We want to thank you for sending in your name, birthday names, or your anniversary that you wanted us to bless you with. And truly, we want to say thank you for that. And we also want to once again thank our graduates who graduated from What Is Unity, our new members as well. We truly know who you are. We want to say thank you for being a part of our service. But right now, we also want to take time at this moment to say this statement right here for being a part.
Thank you all for joining us today. It really means a lot to us as a spiritual community to know that people are watching from home. If anyone wishes to make a love offering, please do so online at www.detroitunity.com and click the donate button or mail to Detroit Unity Temple, 17505 2nd Avenue, Detroit, Michigan, 48203, or place it in the drop box at the Temple's 2nd Avenue entrance.
And Unity Worldwide Ministry would like to ask that we all join with them in saying this prayer, which we say every Sunday. We know that God is a love that has no end and a power that knows no bounds. God's healing power of divine life is restoring, healing, and revitalizing our world in this very moment. We let go of any fears or anxiety, and we affirm that all are safe, healthy, and protected. We bless all those who support us in maintaining vibrant, radiant health. We express divine life in all we think, say, and do. We bless our global family with radiant health, peace of mind, and abundant love. So we say thank you. And during this COVID period, we want to say thank you to our nurses our healthcare workers, our policemen, our firemen, and all those who are essential to our well-being each and every day. Please know that we love you, we support you, and all those who are out there right now with peaceful protesting to make sure that we can bring restorative justice and change in our community. Know that right now we are there with you. And if you've been watching this service, we have dedicated this service to change in our community, not only with our community policing, but with you. And every Thursday, remember, we give out food through our community right here at Detroit Unity Temple. So be a part of this change and know that, imagine, you can make a difference. I want to say thank you to my colleague right here, Mr. T.C. Four, T.C.V., T.C. Five, five generations.
To everyone who's out, you know, risking your body, risking your mental fortitude for the sake of advancing our lives, our children's lives, our grandchildren's lives, always remember that what starts with words on a sign can end with a better life. But it takes discipline, it takes dedication, and it takes the true loving spirit of God that you allow to enter you and the person next to you.
To Gwen and Charles, thank you. To Billy Edwards, to Bessie, to Melanie, to all of you, we just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. And for those of you who are watching, tell someone that you love them. And so it is, let us close now with our prayer of protection and our peace song.
Thank you.
stand I take. Let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth and let it you